The Bogosity Podcast, early and ad-free. Become a subscriber at Patreon, Subscribestar, or Discord. Use the links at donate.bogosity.tv.
Welcome to the Bogosity Podcast for the week of June 2, 2024, the podcast that burst its own bubble. This is your host, Shane Killian. Let's terabrate the news of the bogus. We'll start off with more news in a couple of the big AI cases, starting with a case that used to be called just T versus OpenAI, until they decided an actual name would be better than just a letter representing an anonymous plaintiff. The case caption has been updated to make the lead plaintiff Marilyn Cusart, and so it's now Cusart v. OpenAI. Anyway, the case soon went the way of other AI cases before that when, just a day later, Judge Vince Chhabria threw out pretty much all of the case. And if you want to know why, here's a pro tip. When you're bringing a case, make sure it actually makes sense and isn't a bunch of long-winded rhetoric that gives the judge a migraine. He ruled, "The plaintiff's First Amended complaint, which spans almost 200 pages, fails to present a short and plain statement showing the plaintiffs are entitled to relief. While the length of a complaint alone is unlikely to result in dismissal, when a complaint is needlessly long and contains largely irrelevant, distracting, or redundant information, dismissal under Rule 8A is appropriate. Here, the complaint is not only excessive in length, but also contains swaths of unnecessary and distracting allegations to determine the adequacy of the plaintiff's legal claims. To cite just a couple of examples, the plaintiff spent over 5 pages on how various political leaders and European governments have reacted to recent advancements in AI technology, and 3+ pages discussing copyright concerns, even though none of the plaintiffs assert a copyright claim. He also didn't like their policy grievances and hysteria that AI has the same risk to humanity as nuclear weapons. He concluded, "Because the court has no way of telling whether the plaintiffs could adequately state a claim once all the mud is scraped off the walls of the complaint, dismissal is with leave to amend. But if the amended complaint continues to focus on general policy concerns and irrelevant information in a way that interferes with a clear presentation of the legal claims at issue, it will be dismissed with prejudice. Moreover, if the plaintiffs manage to state a claim that gets past the pleading stage, they should know that, given the way the current version of the complaint was drafted, it's unlikely that they or their counsel can be trusted to adequately and responsibly represent the interests of absent class members in a federal lawsuit." Yikes! That's letting them have it! So after that, he denied with prejudice Microsoft's motion to compel arbitration, as that was now moot. The case isn't dead. We can expect an amended complaint, but seriously, they need to do a lot better than what they did. In the meantime, OpenAI is still having to litigate Tremblay v. OpenAI, where Magistrate Judge Robert M. Illman basically scolded plaintiffs for being squabbly children in the beautiful way a proper judge can do. The plaintiffs are wanting to do a bunch of depositions, and so defendants want a 30-day stay to prepare, the judge ruled. For their part, plaintiffs respond by claiming that OpenAI's delay campaign continues. Plaintiffs are adamant about moving forward with their deposition now, and, in their portion of the letter brief, have set forth the topics they intend to cover and have asserted their relevance to their case. What plaintiffs have not done is address the question of why a 30-day stay would prejudice their case, other than stating, without explanation, that not taking this deposition now would limit plaintiffs' ability to prepare for the June 18 settlement conference. The picture that seems to be emerging from the parties' series of discovery disputes thus far is that the parties are not exactly proceeding through the discovery process with the degree of collegiality and cooperation that might be optimal. This is the third dispute the parties have brought before the court, and frankly, The court believes that all three disputes should have been resolved without the need for judicial intervention. The court hopes that, moving forward, counsel for the parties will put forth a significantly greater effort at narrowing or resolving their disputes without having to involve the court each and every time they find something about which to disagree. That said, the court finds the defendant's request for a 30-day delay as to the schedule for depositions in this case is well-founded, not just because defendants have claimed they need the time to prepare their witness, but also so that all counsel in the OpenAI cases can meet and confer further, such as to explore every avenue through which the discovery process, and depositions in particular, in these cases may be streamlined and made efficient. Thus, defendants' request to stay depositions in this case for a 30-day period is granted. In the meantime, plaintiffs would be well advised to cooperate with defendants in the process of streamlining discovery coordination and deposition procedures across the OpenAI cases, given that the court is sympathetic to defendants' concerns about duplicative depositions on the same topics constituting an avoidable burden and a waste of resources. Yeah, because a lot of this just seems like the goal is to put a burden on OpenAI and make them pay in legal expenses. The process is the punishment. Which seems to be the point of most of these anti-AI cases. It's not the behavior of lawyers who know they have a winning case. It's more like the case of the Sandy Hook plaintiffs against Remington, where, as we covered, a case that should never have been let through the door resulted in Remington being bullied into bankruptcy. The difference is, in these cases, the plaintiffs seem to have trouble finding corrupt judges who'll do what they want. Unlike a certain prosecutor we'll cover in the next segment. If you're looking for a way to support this channel, but you don't have any spare cash and you can't stand ads, you can do so by generating your own cryptocurrency. Use the links at the bottom of the description to follow the link to Odyssey.com to listen to the podcast and see all of my YouTube videos as well. Just watching videos will produce cryptocurrency for the creator and yourself. And since Odyssey is always monetized and never censored, you'll have no problem seeing all the videos from your favorite creators. You can also use the library credits you create at Odyssey to tip creators and even purchase paid content. Earn library credits through various rewards, including daily view rewards and the number of shares and invites. And you can interact with creators in all sorts of ways, including like and dislike, comment, boost a post by supporting it, repost it, and share to other sites, all while earning crypto for the creator. Easily monetize yourself and your favorite creators using cryptocurrency without advertising. Use the link below to visit this channel on Odyssey.com and see many of your other favorites there as well.
All right, welcome back, everyone. We are in the Double Jeopardy round, and Shane, you have control of the board.
Okay, I'll take foregone conclusions for 800, Alex.
The answer is the jury verdict in the Alvin Bragg Trump hush money trial.
What is guilty on all counts?
Correct. Guilty on all 34 counts, and that puts our legal system in jeopardy.
Indeed it does, Alex, and that's not just the view of Trump fans. People all over the political landscape have been criticizing this entire trial for violating basic norms. And that's something we should mention before we get too far into this. If you're basing your opinion on this trial either way on whether you love or hate Donald Trump, you're doing it wrong. Justice should be examined with no regard for the individual particularities of the defendant. And even if the jury hadn't been selected from an incredibly biased venue, as we covered, it still seems they had little room to maneuver to even consider a not guilty verdict. In fact, it's so bad that lawyers and pundits are expecting this to be reversed so fast it'll leave skid marks. Just to summarize some of the grounds. We have constitutional violations for selective prosecution, where other politicians engaged in actual fraud, including the Steele dossier, and were given just a slap on the wrist. In addition, the defense mentioned other cases where a politician paid hush money during an election, one being Arnold Schwarzenegger, who paid off a Playboy model who claimed to have an affair with him, and who were never charged. All of this amounts to selective prosecution, absolutely an appealable offense on its own. There were also some pretty major due process violations. As we covered, previous prosecutors didn't want to bring the case, and even Alvin Bragg, who campaigned on prosecuting Trump, decided not to pursue this case because of how bad it is. That was when Matthew Colangelo left the Biden Justice Department to go join Letitia James's team, and he was sent down to Manhattan to make sure Bragg moved the case forward. He was one of the prosecutors in the case, so this has Biden's fingerprints all over it. Then we have the judge's conflicts that we covered. He was a Biden donor and donated to other Democratic causes, and his daughter raises tens of millions of dollars for people like Adam Schiff, often specifically using this very prosecution in her fundraising emails. That would mean pretty much automatic recusal from any but the most biased judge to avoid even the appearance of impropriety. Another problem was explained well by Jonathan Turley.
I disagree with this verdict. I think, as I've said before, that this case was legally unfounded. When they were reading those guilty verdicts, the one thing that we didn't know is really what he was found guilty of. Because if you remember, the judge allowed the jury to find guilt on any one of three secondary crimes. We weren't told whether the jury found any one of those crimes, whether they found all three of those crimes. I'm not too sure we will know that. That's one of the many issues that I think presents reversible problems in this case.
You see, for this to be a felony, the false business record has to be made for the purpose of furthering another crime. What was that crime? The prosecution had told the jury, quote, "The indictment doesn't specify it because the law does not so require." In other words, we don't have to tell you. Just make up whatever crime you want. The judge's jury instruction said basically the same thing. They didn't even say anything about that until closing arguments. And another terrible thing that New York courts do is defense's closing arguments are first. Then the prosecutor makes theirs with no chance for the defendant to respond. In most jurisdictions, it's the other way around, although the prosecution is allowed a brief rebuttal. So the one and only thing that makes this possible was told to the jury by the prosecution when the defense had no chance whatsoever to respond to it. The prosecutor told the jury that crime could have been a campaign violation, or it could have been a tax violation, or a falsification of other records. And the judge said that the jury didn't even have to agree on which one it was. That flies in the face of Supreme Court precedent. In Richardson v. United States, Justice Breyer ruled, "We must decide whether a jury has to agree unanimously about which specific violations make up the continuing series of violations. We hold that the jury must do so. That is to say, a jury must unanimously agree not only that the defendant committed some continuing series of violations, but also that the defendant committed each of the individual violations necessary to make up that continuing series." And yet, Mershon's instructions to the jury read, "Under our law, a person is guilty of falsifying business records in the first degree when, with intent to defraud that includes an intent to commit another crime or to aid or conceal the commission thereof, that person makes or causes a false entry in the business records of an enterprise." So the jury should have to agree unanimously on which crime he committed. Was it tax fraud? Campaign finance violation? Whatever it is, they all have to agree on it, and Judge Mershon lied and told them otherwise. Mershon also denied advice of counsel defense and even attacked Trump's counsel when they asked it to be included in jury instructions. In fact, those floofy jury instructions are going to give them fertile grounds for appeal. Mershon also didn't allow defense to offer expert testimony about violations of election law, which he allowed Cohen to opine about at length and included in jury instructions. He denied Trump his right as a defendant to absent himself from the trial. And also, the timing of this thing is off. He made these payments in 2017, allegedly to interfere with the 2016 election. So I guess they're accusing him of time travel as well? Not to mention, that's when he was president, and we're waiting for SCOTUS to come back with a presidential immunity decision. That might have a big effect on this as well. There are so many problems with this case, it'll make your head spin. Let's hear more from Turley.
I must tell you, the reason I was sad in there was not for the former president. It was for the New York legal system. I've written, as many of us have, that this is a deeply flawed case. It's wrong. Quite frankly, I think the level of reversible error here really is quite considerable. It runs the waterfront of procedural to constitutional problems, including federal constitutional violations.
And in a different interview?
There was an effective shortening of the football field for the prosecution that may have made this inevitable. I wrote a column yesterday in The Hill that said that it had the feel of a canned hunt, where people are allowed to shoot game in a cage or a small space, because the judge created that small space. I disagree with the judge. To this moment, I don't know what the president was convicted of. The jury verdict form just says they were unanimous that some secondary crime was the basis of these falsified document violations. So the judge said, you could just pick anything on the menu. You know, there are three crimes here, a federal election violation, falsification of documents, a tax violation. Go with any or all of them. So we don't even know if they were unanimous on what actually happened. To this day, with that verdict, I don't know what they thought was the conspiracy, what was that secondary crime. That's obviously not right.
And someone else who agrees with all of this is you. John Yoo, I mean, the former Deputy Assistant Attorney General.
The first crime is just a misdemeanor, this bookkeeping entry business. It only becomes a felony, which is something worth jail time, if it's used to cover up or to enable some greater felony. The prosecution has still to tell us what that second felony is. Now, a good judge, an impartial judge, would send this case back to the prosecutors and say, you can't proceed any further. Instead, Judge Merchan just sort of let it go, see what's going to happen. Every time that Judge Merchan has had a really serious choice in this trial, he has sided with DA Alvin Bragg. I think the cautious thing to do, especially when we have crossed the Rubicon to allow the first prosecution of an American president in the history of the country, you would want everything to be ship-shape and buttoned up. And instead, this has been a kind of, how would you put it, just sort of the Judge Merchan has become a free-form trial where he's calling really difficult questions on the fly, and I think he could have serious problem on appeal.
I know this segment is running way long, but before we wrap this up, I do think we need to hear from Alan Dershowitz.
This is a very sad day for American justice. It's a worse day for America than it actually is for Donald Trump. This is still the weakest case I've ever seen in 60 years. The fact that the jury convicted based on false instructions, wrong instructions, based on the jurors having been between 85 and 90% picked from a veneer that hates Trump and doesn't want him to be president. The fact that the jury convicted doesn't make this case any stronger or any better. We do live in the age of Trump syndrome, of people can't talk rationally about Donald Trump any more than they can talk rationally about Israel or about some other subjects. It's not surprising that a jury would come back guilty on all counts for crimes that, after 60 years of experience as a criminal lawyer, I still don't understand. I don't understand how you can resurrect a statute of limitation barred misdemeanor and turn it into a viable felony because maybe Trump thought when somebody signed a bookkeeping entry from a menu that the appropriate listing was legal expenses rather than something that's not on the menu, a reimbursement for a non-disclosure agreement. How you can then turn that into a felony by saying, but at the time that somebody else did it, he must have intended to commit another crime. This was a foreordained verdict, and I very much worry about what this is going to mean for America. It's going to incentivize local prosecutors in red states and red cities of red states to bring fake charges against Democrats. You have Trump supporters who are outraged by the verdict, and you have Biden supporters who support it. And then you have me, a Biden supporter. I voted for him in the last election. Don't know who I'm going to vote for in this election, but I've never voted for Donald Trump. who was outraged by this verdict, was outraged by the charges. Even if there had been an acquittal, I'd been outraged. The very fact that somebody is brought to trial on offenses of this kind diminishes our legal system considerably. But there is absolutely no guarantee there'll be a reversal of this conviction, although it should be reversed. Obviously, there are so many errors in this case, just to start with the most obvious one. Prosecutor argued to the jury that it is a fact, not the law, it is a fact that paying of the hush money constituted an illegal campaign contribution. If it was a fact, then the judge had no authority to exclude an expert witness who would have testified to a different fact, who would have said, no, as a matter of fact, there was no crime committed here. The judge said, no, but it's not a question of facts, it's a question of law. And I'll decide that. But he allowed the prosecutor to say it's a question of fact. That in and of itself is a reversible error. There are so many other reversible errors in this case. That doesn't mean there'll be a reversal. This case is different. Oliver Wendell Holmes once said that hard cases make bad law. Political cases also make bad law. And this is very much a political case.
And the fact that all of these legal experts are confused over it means that either this is a massively improper application of the law, or the law itself is void for vagueness. The problem is, although there's basically no way this decision will stand, even if the lower appellate courts are cowards and it has to go all the way to SCOTUS, the fact is, none of that will happen before the election. And that's the whole idea. For the 2024 election, Biden and the news media will keep being able to say that Trump is a convicted felon. Of course, after the verdict, there are reports that traffic to Trump's donation site overwhelmed the server and took it down. So, go figure that. Whether or not this will help or hurt his chances remain to be seen, but always remember, the Streisand effect is a thing. If you're on the Wi-Fi in a coffee shop or hotel, anyone on that network can get your traffic. Do you really trust all of those strangers? For that matter, do you really trust your ISP? A VPN can protect you from prying eyes, disguise your location, and even foil government sensors. It's essential in this day and age, so go to vpn.pagosity.tv and you'll be taken to BoxPN. Starting at just $2.99 a month, you can get unlimited high-speed connections to VPN servers all over the world, and they don't log connections, so your privacy is assured. Traveling abroad, just VPN home, and don't worry about what those other governments are doing. Back at home, stop your ISP from traffic shaping and messing with the quality internet access you're paying good money for. You can connect from multiple machines at once, including your smartphone or tablet, and it supports all the secure standards, including OpenVPN and SSTP. Bypass sensors and surveillance with your own secure VPN connection. Go to vpn.pagosity.tv. So this edition has ended up being a kind of court case special. There's just been so much legal stuff to talk about. We've been covering the case Cox Communications has been fighting against the big music cartels, defending their rights and the privacy of their users. We covered the ridiculous $1 billion judgment the court dumped on them a few years ago. Cox has been appealing. And all sorts of crap has come out since then. In the latest, it turns out the music companies concealed evidence from them that should have been turned over in discovery, damaging the foundation of the lawsuit. The Fourth Circuit's decisions have been mixed so far. They did affirm that Cox was liable for subscribers who were pirating, but reversed that ridiculous infringement finding and vacated the $1 billion judgment. They ordered a new trial. Cox filed a motion for relief of judgment, appealing the district court's conclusion that the music company's concealing evidence didn't hamper their defense any. The evidence involved the piracy tracking system from Mark Monitor, which is basically the digital equivalent of crystal balls and horoscopes, through which the music companies send out thousands of copyright infringement notices. During the trial, the music companies provided a hard drive containing music files they said were the ones pirated between 2012 and 2014. But looking at information that surfaced during their lawsuit against Charter and Bright House, Cox learned that this evidence had been created after the fact, using hash values supplied by the record labels. 2 years ago, Cox revealed this and submitted a motion for relief saying, quote, and the prejudice to Cox could not be clearer. They were intended to, and did, fend off well-founded challenges to the admissibility of key pieces of evidence, the exclusion of which would have crippled plaintiff's case. The bottom line is that plaintiffs lied. They lied to Cox, they lied to the court, and they lied to the jury. And they rode those lies to a $1 billion judgment. But District Judge Liam O'Grady literally said that perjury and fabricating evidence was of no consequence. And also, it was Cox's fault for not catching it earlier. So now, before the Fourth Circuit, Cox is saying that O'Grady erred, and this is of key importance, quote, "Needless to say, the reliability of Mark Monitor's system was all important, and Cox had every interest in attacking it. But Cox was deprived of the opportunity to scrutinize Mark Monitor's system fully, something it would learn only after judgment was entered. The truth came out when district courts in cases plaintiffs brought against other ISPs forced plaintiffs to turn over evidence plaintiffs had deliberately concealed from Cox." O'Grady had based his technologically ignorant claim on the idea that Mark Monitor's system checks hash values, and hash values never change as long as the file doesn't change. But any file can have a hash. Just because there's a hash doesn't mean the file was pirated. And Mark Monitor apparently failed to find any pirated music files for many of the hash values. When that came out in the charter trial, the music companies quickly settled. One day before trial, Cox filed, and lo and behold, the charter evidence ultimately revealed that the 2016 project failed to confirm some of the original entries in the Mark Monitor database. With this laid bare, plaintiffs in charter were forced to develop an entirely new approach to proving the system's reliability and thus direct infringement. They hired a gaggle of new experts, then settled before trial could test this new method. Plaintiffs thus deprived Cox of evidence that would have squarely undermined the reliability of the Mark Monitor notice system and therefore plaintiff's direct infringement case. If any of the hash values are bad, then how can you trust the rest? This is supposed to be pure math. A hash is a deterministic number calculated from the bits in the file. And the very excuse O'Grady used that the hash never changes is exactly the problem. Because if even a single one of them doesn't match anything, that means there has to be something wrong with Mark Monitor's system, and it just can't be trusted. Quote, "Cox still does not know precisely what this code does, but public documents from Charter and Bright House indicate that the code governs at least the process by which Mark Monitor supposedly verified that files it found on peer-to-peer networks matched copyrighted works. The district court in Bryant House was determined to get to the bottom of this. It summoned Mark Monitor's corporate representative to appear in court and explicitly commanded that plaintiff's counsel shall not coach him in advance. Plaintiff settled the day before that appearance." They're asking for a new trial so the evidence can be properly tested and scrutinized. Hopefully we'll get more answers regarding exactly what the music cartels have been doing to us and how they've been manipulating and corrupting the court system in the process. Do you have children or nieces or nephews? Are you homeschooling or just want to counter some of the socialist indoctrination most children get in school? If so, go to bogosity.tv/TuttleTwins, and you'll be taken to a website where you can get some great books for elementary-age children. The Tuttle Twins books are books about liberty and free market economics that include children's versions of Bastiat's The Law, Leonard Reed's I, Pencil, and Hayek's The Road to Serfdom, as well as books about the Federal Reserve and how regulations protect business cronies. They'll learn about the harm caused by eminent domain, or regulations passed in the name of safety, and fundamental concepts of liberty. And as you can see from the sample pages on the website, they're all easy to read and nicely illustrated. They're just $9.99 apiece, or get a special discount as well as free bonuses when you purchase all five. You can even buy in bulk to donate to schools and local libraries. So get the Tuttle Twins books at bogosity.tv/TuttleTwins. And now it's time to homogenize this week's biggest bogon emitter. And this week, it goes to Senate Democrats in something that isn't really a court case, but is court adjacent, as they made an absolute jackass out of themselves to Justice Roberts. Get it? Democrats? Jackass? Okay, then. Between threats of court packing and trying to get conservative judges kicked off the bench, it's clear the Democrats have been trying to undermine the Supreme Court every chance they get. But now, they're trying to use the free speech of their spouses as an excuse to make them recuse themselves, and they ordered Alito to come in and explain himself to them. The thing that needs explaining? His wife, Martha Ann, flew the American flag on their house upside down. She also flew an Appeal to Heaven flag, the pine tree flag commissioned under George Washington's Continental Army. The American flag is supposed to be flown upside down in times of distress. It's generally used as a form of peaceful protest. Technically, it's against the flag code, yes, there's a flag code, to fly it upside down except as, quote, a signal of dire distress in instances of extreme danger to life or property. But any attempt to prosecute someone on that basis would be instantly smacked down as a First Amendment violation. As a precedent, the flag code makes it illegal to burn a flag for any reason other than disposal. Yet the Supreme Court repeatedly upheld flag burning as a form of protest protected under the First Amendment. We don't know why she flew the flag upside down, but it's easy to imagine it being the result of the recent Trump guilty verdict we just spent a lot of time covering. Anyway, Democrats are now using it as an excuse to demand that Alito recuse himself from any cases involving Trump or any Jan 6 protesters. Because that's really the thing you need to recuse yourself over, and not little things like your daughter raising tens of millions of dollars using the very case you're presiding over. They demanded that Alito come in and explain himself, and he wrote back to them, basically blowing them off. So now they're trying to get Chief Justice Roberts in. He blew them off too, quote, I must respectfully decline your request for a meeting. That's the polite, judgy way of saying F off. See, there's this thing called separation of powers. The Supreme Court can't tell Congress what legislation to pass. And by the same token, Congress can't tell the Supreme Court what cases to take or who can preside over them. It's not the first time he's done this. Last year, he declined to testify before the Judiciary Committee, saying that judges rarely meet with lawmakers and, quote, moreover, the format proposed, a meeting with leaders of only one party who have expressed an interest in matters currently pending before the court, simply underscores that participating in such a meeting would be inadvisable. He's got your number, Democrats. Also, check the archives. We've covered before what would happen if such tangential reasons were a valid demand for recusal, and it's so broad it would result in all 9 justices having to recuse themselves from any Trump or Biden trial for one reason or another. And this is basic 8th grade civic stuff. Legislative, executive, judicial. 3 branches, separate and equal. It's embarrassing that Democrats in Congress apparently don't understand this. So for making absolute fools of themselves, Senate Democrats have to be this week's biggest bogey emitter. I want to tell you about the eyeglasses I've been wearing for years. As people can see on my videos, I have a very strong prescription, which makes glasses more expensive, especially when I need computer glasses, reading glasses, prescription sunglasses, and most expensively, progressive lenses for general everyday wear. To save money while still getting quality glasses, I get them from Firmoo. In fact, I just got a pair of progressives with high-index aspherical lenses and a nice pair of frames my wife loves for just over $100. It would have been $500 to get them through my eye doctor. Not only do they look good, the glasses are durable. I've worn many pairs for several years without problems. All orders come with a 30-day return policy, a 3-month warranty, and one-on-one customer service. Go to Firmoo, that's FIRMOO.Pogosity.TV, anytime you need quality glasses at a low price. Once again, that's Firmoo.Pogosity.TV. And now let's Bolshevize this week's
Idiot Extraordinaire.
And speaking of embarrassing, the Supreme Court issued another 9-0 smackdown, this time the state of New York, for blatantly violating the First Amendment rights of the NRA. The state had required regulated financial agencies to punish or suppress the NRA's activities regarding gun promotions. The state had ordered banks and insurance companies not to do business with the NRA, blaming them for a 2018 shooting that occurred in Florida. It's not just that it was unanimously against them, but it's very significant that the opinion of the court was delivered by none other than Justice Sotomayor, and she was in rare form. It's certainly better than her ridiculous ruling in Warhol, but anyway. Citing Bantam Books v. Sullivan, she ruled, "Government officials cannot attempt to coerce private parties in order to punish or suppress views that the government disfavors. Ultimately, Bantam Books stands for the principle that a government official cannot do indirectly what she is barred from doing directly. A government official cannot coerce a private party to punish or suppress disfavored speech on her behalf." She found that the NRA's allegations, if true, those haven't been adjudicated yet, are absolutely a violation of the First Amendment, and remanded the case back down on that basis. In a concurrence, Gorsuch wrote, "Indeed, the Second Circuit's decision to break up its analysis into discrete parts and take the complaint's allegations in isolation appears only to have contributed to its mistaken conclusion that the National Rifle Association failed to state a claim. Lower courts would therefore do well to heed this court's directive. Whatever value these guideposts serve, they remain just that and nothing more. Ultimately, the critical question is whether the plaintiff has plausibly alleged conduct that, viewed in context, could be reasonably understood to convey a threat of adverse government action in order to punish or suppress the plaintiff's speech." It's sad that government actors had to be told this, but now it's clear. The principles in Bantam Books are binding on all courts and apply to all cases that meet its criteria. And the big question is what this means for pending cases, most notably Murthy v. Missouri, which seeks to prevent the Biden administration from engaging in backdoor censorship of the kind revealed by the Twitter files. In fact, both that case and this one were argued on March 18th, so we might get an answer on that one as well very soon. So anyway, it goes back down to the lower court, and here's hoping it enables the NRA to get the justice we all deserve. At least SCOTUS did their part. So all of that makes New York this week's
Idiot Extraordinaire!
Well, that wraps up this, no, sorry, I can't retain that, I've tried, it's just not going in, edition of the Bogosity Podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please go to donate.bogosity.tv for several ways to support, and discord.bogosity.tv to join the discussion. Subscribe at the Discord or at Patreon or Subscribestar, and you can listen early and ad-free. Thank you for listening. Until next time, here's a quote from Benjamin Franklin. "Whoever would overthrow the liberty of a nation must begin by subduing the freeness of speech." The Bogosity Podcast is licensed under Creative Commons Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives, 4.0 International License.
Bogosity.